I'm Katherine, and
I'm Ananya,
and we're both like officers for Princeton Students for Gender Equality student organization here. So we wanted to kind of, obviously we won't be able to cover everything, but we wanted to kind of give an outline of some of the things we see as like important issues for action in terms of combating gender inequality and sexism right here on our campus at Princeton. And like we wanted to also give some like hopeful notes about really cool stuff that's going on campus, and we think it's like definitely intensified this year. And obviously we want to open it up for discussion as well. So we wanted to start something that we see as the root of a lot of current issues is like Princeton's very troubled history with going co-ed and integrating in terms of gender. And so some things that we wanted to highlight were the history with like eating clubs and exclusion, and then the dynamics that still exist today, and then like with just more generally with like the difficulties in terms of like social life and academics that like female students faced when they like first were allowed into Princeton, and kind of how we see echoes of that today. So do you have a connection? I'm just going to screen. Okay, so Ananya found this really cool book, like Reflections of by Women on Princeton, and it's like a lot of women from the first classes at Princeton reflecting on their experiences. So she has like a, I'm gonna use a projector. She has like a screenshot from the book talking about issues with social inclusion and social dynamics that this like early student faced. And we wanted to relate that today because we think it's still like really relevant.
So basically, it was this book created by four undergraduate women who were among the first classes, first women to graduate from Princeton in the 70s and the 90s. And they created this book called Women Reflected Princeton, where they just accumulated quotes of some of the female graduates and compared them. And comparing them to women today who still go here, a lot of it is still really relevant. So I'm just going to read this aloud. This one anonymous student from the class of 77 says, another thing I resented was the import situation. Men who thought you were good enough to play tennis with or to borrow lecture notes from suddenly went blind on Friday at about 4 o'clock. If you saw them at a party, they looked right through you, or were so riveted by the sweet briar blonde's conversation that they couldn't spare you a glance. I suppose that I could put all my complaints in a nutshell by saying that I didn't feel there was a place for me at Princeton socially. Although I did the club scene, it was far from a comfortable fit, and there didn't seem to be an alternative. If I could change one thing about Princeton, I'd burn down every single club in Prospect Avenue, which I think is a sentiment that's still really relevant and resonates today. There are a lot of these books that are in the Women's Center just down the hallway from old old reflections about Princeton, and they are more intersectional than you would assume. This focuses also on specifically Black women's experiences at early Princeton, and I don't know if you've read Michelle Obama's senior thesis, but it was specifically about how Black students are treated at Princeton, and within that experience, the experience of being a Black female student. So this is just an introduction to what we'll be, like, some of the stuff we'll be talking about today. But did anyone have any, like, initial comments, I would say, in terms of specific things that you might have been, like, coming here specifically to focus on? And we could see if we can emphasize that more, because there's a lot to talk about.
Okay. So I guess we could start with, like, talking about some of, like, how we feel this is still a really relevant sentiment and experience today. So a lot of you may know this, but when Sally Frank, the woman who like sued Tiger Inn to make it go co-ed because it was one of the holdouts that like really did not want to let women in,
when 1991.
Yeah, 1991. So like well after women had started, not well after because it's still a really short history, but like a decent amount of time had gone by of like having women at Princeton and they still had not gone co-ed. So when Sally Frank came back to speak a couple years ago, there was an email circulated among like TI members, like come, like help us, like protest the woman who like made us go co-ed, and like made us have like gender equality. And she was like not, she was not welcomed by some of the membership. And I think that like that history of like exclusion definitely informs the experiences of like women with the eating club system today, in terms of like the dynamics with like Bicker and the PASS system. There have been a lot of good articles written by students about this. For example, there was this article published in the NAS Weekly, which talked about the gendered and like sexual dynamics of the PASS system in terms of like upperclassmen male students who are members, like giving passes to underclassmen girls, especially freshman girls, kind of with the implicit expectation of some sort of like sexual favor in return, or some sort of like relationship in return. And the fact that like, because like Princeton has this ban on like freshmen rushing sororities and fraternities, she was arguing that before, like before this ban was instituted, like freshman girls and sophomore girls had a way to get passes from other girls rather than from like upperclassmen men who sometimes kind of pressure them into like sexual relationships. But we're not saying sororities are like the answer, because we think that there's like really complex conversation to be had about like the role of like sororities and fraternities in issues on campus in terms of like gender equality and like rape culture. But like, we just wanted to like put that out there as like something about like the dynamics of the PASS system in eating clubs and kind of the legacy of this history of exclusion.
So this article was from 2014, which was not that long ago. And this two officers, in Tiger Inn, the vice president, and I think the treasurer, were circulating this on the listserv which includes many women. So I don't know how they're not. Not gonna get out, but they basically circulated this video of a woman performing a sexual act on the dance floor with the subject line like Asian chick something, and then also when Sally Frank talks about, they said to come tomorrow and help boo Sally Frank for helping turn Eden Club's co-ed. So since then, since 2014, there has been an increase in the number of women in leadership of these Eden clubs, such as like Ivy and Tiger Inn. But that's not necessarily indicative of progress. A lot of the times, it's simply the board members who are saying, like, you need to institute a female president so that we don't get shut down or that this is really bad press. But that's not to say that there's been significant decrease in the rape culture recently as a result of this.
And then also speaking to the line from the quote from the book that Ananya found about how it's like the men were more interested in talking to like girls from other schools. Something that we have been talking about a lot recently is the dynamic of like this idea that like Princeton girls like aren't attractive enough and like aren't like desirable people to like date, and like instead you should like look to for example, I overheard a conversation in the dining hall that I found like shocking, but where this boy was saying to a female friend, like, I'm gonna go like browse the market at Penn State to find like an ideal candidate for my like dumb second wife after I like marry smart, like so I can have smart kids like the first time around. Like, and he mentioned like, I'll do what Donald Trump did so I can have like a smart kid and then like have a dumb wife after that. So that was something I overheard like in a dining hall in like a casual conversation. So like it's pretty, it's like not something that's like in the shadows, like it's really out there as like,
and this is just like anecdotal evidence, but honestly, yeah, it's everywhere. It's really pervasive. But people talk about Princeton goggles, meaning like, oh, in the real world she'd be like a 4, but through Princeton goggles she's a 10. Because like what the average attractiveness of the woman here is like somewhat like, I don't know. So I mean these are small instances, like just microaggressions right like here, that are anecdotal, but it honestly is really pervasive. We still call that one class Coast 109 emails for females, because it's like an easy computer science class, and they call it along with rocks for jocks and stars for stoners, emails for females. This is something that shocks me. As like, I'm from the American South, and I thought that like coming up would be a lot more progressive here. But And like even something like that would not fly in my like very conservative high school.
Yeah, so I think that's a good segue in terms of thinking about like sexism in like social interactions and intimate relationships at Princeton. So just like in addition to like that idea that like Princeton girls are like not like as attractive or like dateable because they're really academically driven, I guess, is the reasoning behind that. But something that kind of how this intersects with like racial dynamics and like racialization, something that we thought was really great was like the Asian American Students Association did this poster campaign, like hashtag Asian Girls Everywhere, where they talked about like where they like shared quotes that they like things that had been said to them on campus. So it was things like, I'd like to colonize that ass, or like there were a lot of other ones like, Ananya's gonna, but there were like a lot of really shocking quotes, but just like the way that like sexism intersects with like racism and like Orientalism on campus in terms of like social interactions and like sexual relationships.
So this was one of our discussion topics recently about Asian American women and fetishization specifically, and thanks to the Asian American Students Association's campaign for this, you might have seen these posters on campus that are black and white text and talk about like specific like examples where that intersectionality has come through and people don't ever talk about it really. Internet's being really slow. But that's been really important for dialogue on campus in terms of like specifically combating like that intersectional identity.
Yeah, and something that related to that, or like I think one of the reasons like behind that campaign was this, or what was it sparked by the like that incident?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
So there was like a quote from a fraternity's email listserv that was leaked. That quoted to a Kanye West lyric, "Eating Asian pussy, all we need is sweet and sour sauce." That like obviously like objectified and like cheapened Asian women's bodies in like a really dramatic way. It was kind of launched in response to that. But that was published as a verbatim in this publication, Nas Weekly, that publishes these like, it has like a verbatim column where they have like quotes set on campus. So after that, I was intrigued. So I started investigating and just looking through like the verbatim column. I found like so many like instances of like anti-Asian discrimination, and often like specifically like sexualized, and then also a lot of instances of like rape culture just like overheard in casual conversations. So I recommend like going on the like NASA Weekly website and just like looking through the verbatim column, because like there's some shocking stuff that's like kind of just published as like a fun joke, but like for example, roommate one, "Hey, do you want to go bone some Chinese kids?" Roommate two, "What?" Roommate one, "Sorry, I actually meant to say chicks." So just like kind of a casual interaction like that that's like published as like a funny joke, but is like clearly has a lot of like racial and sexual dynamics going on there. Oh yeah, sure. But yeah, so that like was something that we found really striking, and that like we think there isn't nearly enough like discussion about. But just like also something. There's a lot of like, I feel like hookup culture is like a really big buzzword right now that's like being used a lot to talk about like colleges and like tied in with like drinking culture and stuff like that. But Jamie O'Leary, who's one of the co-presidents of our club, she did interviews with female students at Princeton. So we have this is a plug, but we have this website where we collect like student feminist writing and art and publish it, like things people wrote for classes or just like on their own. But it's a really cool thing that we recommend you check out. It's called The Manifesto. But so Jamie published a paper on this website about what she called like the orgasm gap at Princeton, just talking with female students about their experiences and in terms of like, so we like recommend this paper, but it's a really interesting opportunity to learn about kind of the imbalances in the hookup culture in terms of like power dynamics and also in terms of like dynamics of like sexual pleasure, like unequally distributed. Yeah, so just like there are a lot of cool things to read on this website. We recommend it. And then there's this one like attitudes about sexual assault at Princeton. So yeah, so we recommend this.
And this is a good transition to talking about rape culture and sexual assault on campus as it relates to hookup culture. So I'm sure you've seen the statistics of the youth service, which is one in six total undergraduates experience sexual assault on this campus, and one in four, I believe. And there are student groups that are dedicated to that, specifically to fighting against that specifically, which is really great. Not a resource that a lot of other schools have, because it is such a pervasive problem here. So just speak out, and then obviously the Share Peer campaign, which is really well structured and well run.
And then like connected to that, something that we found striking was like so recently, like the men's swimming and diving team, if some of you heard, was like suspended because their season was suspended because they had some very like there no specifics were like released about what they said, but like there were some very like misogynist and racist emails being sent circulated on their listserv. But recently the editorial board of the Daily Princetonian published something saying that this was like an incursion on free speech, and like defending, kind of making that argument, which we found surprising. But there was a really good dissent that like broke that down. But just like something I think that like that just more generally we see is like very connected to like rape culture and like the normalization of like kind of evaluations of like, because a part of it circulated around like evaluations of like female athletes in terms of their attractiveness. That was an issue with like the Harvard men's teams that got in trouble as well. But just like how that adds to rape culture by like making, like normalizing the like objectification, like evaluation of like, you know, like, and like these are peers, like this isn't like saying like, oh, like that celebrity, like whatever, like this is like someone you sit in class with or like someone you like eat a meal with, just like being like evaluated in like as a sexual object in a way that then like facilitates this kind of like contributes to this like more general like rape culture.
And the relationship between male and female parallel sports teams, like the men's swimming dive team and the women's swimming dive team, is very close. And the it's like some of your best friends you think who are saying some doubt you and the recruits, because it was targeted towards recruits. So that's been a scandal that university sort of released in a very calculated manner, which is, you know, you might have your own opinion about that. In terms of, it did not really garner the same like national attention that maybe some of the other schools' incidences did, and was more addressed very internally.
Yeah, and something that we heard about was there's this like training that the university is doing on like proper social media use and basically how to have like a clean social media profile and like email profile so that you like don't, so to us that seemed kind of like don't get caught rather than don't change your misogynist and racist attitudes. So we were concerned with that kind of approach because we think that it like doesn't get at the more like systemic issues. It more just like addresses like how can you not publicly send out a racist or misogynist email. So we think that that is definitely something that like the conversation needs to be shifted on that in terms of getting it more like structural. Yeah. So branching off from, so something in the We Speak survey, which published like statistics about like sexual misconduct and sexual assault on campus, something that like wasn't talked about as much but that we thought was really important was the rate of like sexual harassment faced by graduate like female graduate students in particular, like 10% reported that they had faced like sexual harassment in some form by like a fellow student or a superior or like a postdoc. So we thought that would be a good segue into what we see as like issues of sexism in like the academic realm, in like in addition to the social realm. And I think concentrated in like STEM fields, because like that's where like, I mean, we don't have like statistics on this, but like in terms of like sexual harassment, but like something that we can like, we think we can like somewhat assume is that like a lot of like this harassment, if done by like a male supervisor, was more likely to have been done in like STEM fields, because those are like so male dominated in terms of faculty. And just a statistic I recently learned from Professor Strolovich, who's really great. She teaches gender in American politics. 76% of Princeton's faculty is male, which is like the worst among the top 20 universities in this country. So that's something to bear in mind when we think about academic sexism as well.
And for current students, this obviously is speaks to the difference in a major choice in terms of which majors certain genders may go into, or it could, and many other factors as well, but it's just something to think about, that the median income at age 34 for a male Princeton student graduate versus a female Princeton graduate, while they are, you know, obviously it says here among the highest in the Ivy League of New Jersey, it's important, the ratio of 75 to about 110 is right around the ratio of the gender wage gap of 72 cents to the dollar.
I'm just like thinking about, from what like I've read about, like kind of breaking down the particulars of the wage gap, like I'm sure if you broke this down like racially, it would be like even more dramatic. And also something like if you broke it down like married versus single women, because a lot of statistics indicate that like single women, if they're seen as like so committed to their job that they're like not likely to like go like get married and need like maternity leave, are like tend to be paid much closer to what their male colleagues are paid, but like married women are like really especially like penalized in the workforce, especially if they have children. So we were just like really struck by that. Just thinking about our own futures, like we were struck by that wage gap for graduates who are now 34, because that's not that far off from us, from like our futures. And I don't think the answer is that like all women need to like major in STEM. Because like as a humanities major, like as it like, or as like a history major, I'm like, that's what I'm passionate about. But I think that like in general, like addressing the wage gap, but then also addressing like why is it that fields that women tend to be concentrated in are paid so much less? And like why don't we value that kind of work more? Like Anne Marie Slaughter talks about like an ethics of care and like work, like care work, and like a lot of people are addressing this, but like why don't we pay that kind of work more, and like value that kind of work commensurately?
So we wanted to open it up to discussion at this point. And anything we haven't covered or anything anyone would like to know more about, we can definitely speak more to.
Or if you like, yeah, or if you think of like another form of sexism on this campus that we haven't addressed, because we haven't addressed everything by any means.
How do you, you were talking about academic instances of people in power doing things, how do you think that we should go about dealing with tenured professors who abuse their power? I've had multiple friends that have had that experience. One of them actually left the math department because of such treatment from a professor that was tenured.
That's very difficult.
Because
I in terms of sexism, there's not the same resources as perhaps sexual harassment, which, you know, they direct you towards the chair of your women's various networks on campus. Sexism as a forum, like what's been effective, I'm just a freshman here, but what's been most effective from what I've seen is writing about it, and that tends to have a lot, like exposing what's usually unspoken here at Princeton. This year specifically has seen a lot of ground being covered in terms of people speaking out once their identity is taken for granted or marginalized in some way, especially in a way that's super personal like that. Again, that's not easy for us to solution, but who has thoughts about this?
I Title IX office. Title IX office would be appropriate for any dynamic that's like that. And the worst thing that they can do is say, here's another resource, but that will never be the wrong place to go, especially if there's any perception or feeling of targeted, harassed, and the list could go on. So I would always go to Title IX.
There's a teach-in today with the two professors about Title IX and like intersectional assault. And
what does Title IX office mean? Where is it?
Sure. So Sheree Burgess is the name of the point person. It's under the Vice Provost Michelle Mentor in Nassau Hall.
So if someone wants to go there, where do they go? It's an office in Nassau Hall.
Yeah, so there's space in Nassau Hall, and I would also say that anytime you're using a bathroom or facility on campus, there should be a Title IX sign in the stall. If there's not, that's an issue too. And there's information, contact information, also if you just like Google Title IX Princeton University, but it's a policy that protects people against harassment around gender and sexuality.
We also have the Share office in McCosh. If you ever feel like you or someone you know is a victim of sexual harassment or assault, they have advising, so you can go there.
And then, like, in terms of addressing, like, more general, like, culture, like, so my sister goes to Williams, and she's, like, the vice president of, like, American Women in Mathematics chapter. And something that they've been doing is, like, trying to raise awareness about, like, how different math majors' experiences, like, diverge. So they did, like, a poster campaign asking people their thoughts about the math major, and, like, male math majors were, like, predominantly just, like, this is great, I'm doing what I've, like, always wanted to do, and a lot of the female and, like, minority students' experiences reflected around the fact that they were felt like they were being, like, constantly doubted and, like, evaluated differently, and, so, and my sister's poster, like, addressed what she felt is, like, a cult of, like, male genius in math classes, and they asked this one person talked about having a conversation with a male math major, and he identified everyone he felt was, like, a serious student in the math department, and they were all male, so he didn't regard, like, any of the female students in the math department, including my sister, who I think is, like, the smartest person in the math department, but, like, biased, like, didn't see her as a serious major, so to me, like, that was shocking, but, so that's something that can address, like, a more pervasive culture, and they have, like, all sorts of, like, campaigns going around, like, raising awareness and trying to, like, meet with the department, like, student organizers meeting with the department to work out, like, how can we improve rates of attrition, because, like, gender ratios are, like, pretty equal in, like, introductory classes, but it's when you get, like, higher and higher that they, like, get really drastic. So, like, they've been meeting with, like, the department and, like, preparing reports and, like, doing all these things, so I think that, like, it's a really cool opportunity for, like, student activists to, like, work with departments to try to, like, improve the culture. That doesn't get at the, like, tenured professor issue, but, like, just more generally trying to make it a culture of, like, talking openly about these things rather than, like, kind of hiding them.
I had a question about, like, PD club discussions and how we can make it more inclusive to women. For example, this year I ran Towers Baker, I was a Baker chair, and I made sure that the questions we asked both people, men and female, and women, were appropriate and get to know the person. Do you think not just Tower but other eating clubs can make the bigger process more equal and fair? If there should even be a bigger process, that's another question too.
That's it, yeah. That's it. Thank you, that's an awesome point to bring up, especially because, so I'm a freshman and had been through the bigger process and it's very mysterious, and Katherine is a sophomore and she has nothing to do with that. But from what I've heard from older friends, it's 100% about objectification visually. So if there's any sort of training that you do for your bigger chairs or other, whoever decides the group members, that could be an interesting thing to make sure. I know Tower is a policy for their hands.
Yeah, they asked me to try to.
Okay,
asked me to try to move forward.
Right, that's just not the case with other groups, and they obviously need more oversight. But for example, my friends who pick a cottage would say that there is the or Ivy or Tiger Inn or any of these other eating clubs, which may not institute a positive. They would be talking to her and they, you know, say comments about the body and then decide based off that whether she'd be let in. And I know
of someone who was asked, like, where's the most, like, exotic place you've had sex, like, during the Vicar process? And she was, like, very uncomfortable about that questioning because, like, obviously it implied that, like, you were only, like, not, but, like, I feel like it implied that, like, you were only, like, worthy of being part of that club if you had had, like, an exciting, like, wild, like, sex life. And, like, it kind of, like, put her sexual history at the core of the conversation rather than, like, her personality or, like, her, academic interest or anything.
And I know it seems maybe a bit, like, super, like, frivolous to be discussing even clubs, maybe, in terms of, like, the, like, really intense other gender issues on campus, but it does constitute 72%, I think statistic is, of all undergraduate students here, and sexual assault is most likely to take place sophomore year when bigger happens. That's according to the We Speak survey that came out this year. And these dynamics of this co-ed social club can, with little oversight, because they're all Princeton's campus and they're independent private clubs, really has, like, conducted an atmosphere where these things happen at a higher level. Any thoughts that anyone wants to offer?
I was kind of meetings where they spoke that statistic, and it's clear that there is some correlation between Vicar and that statistic being so high. And the people at the top of the list were asked about this, where they said, well, it might be high because this is, like, February's one full month and we get a full month of data. There are other months we don't get a month of data, so it might be making the statistics seem low. And as a statistician, for that. But this inability or this inability to actually acknowledge that there might be some strong relationship there from the university officials who are overseeing the survey was a bit.
Wow. Even for a committee where there were, that's like the.
This is the USLC committee. Wow. A professor pointed out that Vicar happened then. And that was, the answer was that. It was, there might be other causes to why the statistics so high at that time, not that there was actually a problem with the process.
Part of that might be a fear of retaliation, right?
I don't know. But I mean, I think if you're putting all this effort in to kind of try to pinpoint the problem and really address it, it seems counterproductive to not even admit to the correlation. Like, there's no causation necessarily there that you could pinpoint, but to really speak that there is a correlation here that we should look into and address, ignoring that was a bit concerning.
We had a so Princeton has a freshman ban on fraternities and sororities, we had a PSGE discussion about it where several sorority members and fraternity members showed up to talk about, you know, the gender inequality that they felt was there. And so that brush takes place sophomore year, in September. And the people who were in the sorority said that it was commonly known around from guys as Christmas in September, as the day night when all the new sorority members go out to Cosmo Gathering. And that's just like Christmas in September. That indicates like such like malicious and disgusting tones about sophomore year as a female. Which it does constitute a lot of the student body who participates in, like, the street, and because that's a large part of Princeton's culture.
And, like, I know that the sororities do, like, some of the sororities do have, like, a system where, like, the older members, like, look out for the, like, new girls when they, like, go out for the first time, but, like, the fact that there still is this culture of, like, yay, like, fresh, like, girls to, like, target is, like, really shocking.
And so that's just like sophomore year is a really tumultuous time for a lot of these dynamics, and having an entire almost first semester devoted to like your social, you want to know more about this, maybe not so much in tower because it's a nice one, but in terms of like crafting your like social entrance into the world of Vicar for sophomore year, for like February. Vicar happens in February of your sophomore year. And what's often the trend is that if you choose to partake in the Vicar system, you spend a significant portion of your freshman year and the early sophomore year like trying to gain the social cues to enter these clubs, which are often very gendered, like Katherine's talking about obtaining classes for women.
One last quick question about the picture. I have another question about your weight later, but the picture, I'm a grad student, so I don't know so much about how the inclines operate. But are there people that can maybe work for the university? I know there's separate entities, but the people in the university that work there maybe as an advisor, like how to guide these processes, because if you do it just with the students there, my thought is the attrition rate just for faculty graduating, if there's no institutional history of how things have been happening and no guidance on how things should not happen or should. Is there something in place like this?
So if I'm not mistaken, there's a board of trustees, right, for alumni. It's of alumni, but that's like the only like long-standing.
We decide how the actual process runs. Each club has their own traditions. For example, Tower does, it's called round robin interviews, and then for example, your question might get something like, if you were a senior right now, what would you write your thesis on? So like, just to get to know the person. Other clubs might ask more sexual questions like, what if you had sex, or what was your best sex? There's absolutely no oversight. And that university district, I think, believes in that, the separation, because it is an independent institution.
This is just really important because, you know, some of the dynamics you're talking about are present in across higher ed, right? And some of them are very, very particular to this campus culture. And so, you know, this is the only college you know. And so, you know, but I think that some of what you're talking about here is just very baked into Princeton's culture. And so it makes it, I think, really important for those of us who live and work here to sort of figure out how to address these things as they exist in their particularity for us at Princeton. And I think one of the things you're underlining for us is the, you know, the ways in which the eating club culture is like right at the center of that.
I don't know if anyone knows this information. I'm just kind of curious as to why the university is allowed to ban Rush of frats as independent organizations freshman year, but they're not allowed to do or don't want to do anything about their sophomore year of eating clubs. It seems to me they're similar independent organizations. The university can exercise some power, but not always power. I don't know if anyone knows anything about that.
This is just totally out of nowhere, but I would guess it has to do with donors, like having graduated here and participated in the eating clubs and feeling very strongly about their old eating clubs.
Also, I'm in a fraternity. There's never been a culture of Greek life on campus, pretty much recent. And so eating clubs are, as you said, embedded in the Princeton culture, and so they try to protect that a lot. Because it is where we go out. It keeps us away from bars or like using fake IDs and stuff, I'm assuming. There's a lot of policy implication. But the point about, it's weird because they use sophomore rush justifying that women might be objectified or something like that, but it will still happen. You're just postponing it a year.
Eating clubs, I'm going to you since you said you're an officer. Would eating clubs, like, would you as an officer be interested in maybe like having maybe an outside agency? It doesn't have to be necessarily from the school, but maybe someone to like, you know, like I said, be in that advisement role, someone who's like a lot older that you know this problem exists, and someone could like, you know, try to give some sense of order, because like I said, without the guidance, I mean, this problem, we could talk about this as much as we want, but it's not going to change if either school does not, and this is just my opinion, but I'm like, if school doesn't get involved or someone else doesn't get involved to give this guidance, because again, and I said, again, sorry for undergrads, but it's like, you know, these people are just being weaned off the bottle, and it's like, they don't know which way is up, down, and how to think yet. Not, you're learning, that's the whole point of, you know, college in the state. I mean, here I am too, I'm a grad student. The point is, again, without that guidance, I don't know if you can fix it. Would y'all be interested?
Yeah, I agree, but my voice is like a minority voice in the eating club system. Like, I've been active to push for, like, increased university involvement. Like, for example, we recently had this whole debate about should the university collect statistics on race on eating clubs. And I'm not an officer, should the university collect statistics on race to see, you know, what's going on? I ran the bigger class with the bigger chair and no longer an officer, but I was very actively pushing for, why don't collect stats now? But I got a lot of pushback from the Board of Trustees themselves. So they are technically adults. I mean, I have these trustees.
They get millions of dollars a year. Like,
right. So like,
the
even
power
if I
dynamic
to,
is not students, it's yeah. a battle alumni, which is your point.
Well,
so
they have the self-interest, right? That's not
yeah.
necessarily
like I couldn't. I'd probably get kicked out if I collect the stats on the kids.
Yeah, I got you.
If we have a, like, I have an article here from the Doing Things Dirty that discusses this referendum, this push for a referendum.
Because we did, it passed. Like, we voted to release, like, statistics on, like, race and gender and, like, all these categories.
And sexual orientation. And
sexual orientation.
To demystify the process for incoming sophomores, basically. There's a lot, like, of dynamics that go into union clubs, and a lot of them, certain club presidents and officers really, really fought hard against this referendum and said that, and you know, to my knowledge, did they collect the data even though
no,
the referendum passed? Yeah, because they couldn't do anything. It was just a referendum. These clubs are completely independent. Moreover, because they're, I forget the name of the law, but because they're off Princeton's campus, but still part of Princeton, like Princeton police are not who
yeah.
report sexual assault to students.
Yeah, when we have like incidents of like someone like passes out or something, it's not university people coming, it's like actual police department, and it creates like questions. For example, when I was running those parties, if anyone was intoxicated, we were told to take care of them first or ask the bouncer what to do before actually reporting it, because that person would go to PMC and not to Makosh. Or we were told to walk them to Makosh directly instead of, you know, calling whoever they need to be.
A question around gender in general. So I think we've talked about gender in a binary of man and woman. And I recognize on this campus there are several students, faculty, staff who identify as gender non-conforming, trans, gender queer. And so how do folks who don't fit within the binary fit within Princeton?
Right. So that was, there's so much work to be done on that note. This year specifically, as a freshman, I've been surprised by the number of measures which have happened to take place by building, for example, gender-inclusive bathrooms in
housing.
Some buildings.
And housing. And in the Dillon Gym renovation, like, there's a whole, like, area of, like,
yeah.
gender-inclusive or, like, gender-neutral bathrooms. And then they just, they passed, like, a new gender-inclusive housing policy that's, like, much better and, like, I think was, like, really informed by student needs and student experiences. But I think, like, those are some, like, good, like, policy strides, but I think, like, probably, like, socially there's, like, a lot more,
much more
work to be done. And, like, at our like, Students for Gender Equality meetings, like, we do always try to, like, and, like, in events that we hold, we try to, like, use, like, really inclusive language and, like, non-like language that, like, for example, like, we did, like, so one of the projects that we've been working on is, like fighting stigma surrounding, like, menstruation and, like, trying to get, like, pads and tampons in all bathrooms on campus, like, whether they're, like, men's bathrooms, women's bathrooms, or, like, unisex bathrooms. And, like, so we tried to, like, in fighting for that policy, like, we tried to make it, like...
We said uterus owners or people
yeah.
and friends of uterus owners, and we did get pushback from a certain publication
yeah.
on campus, which was, like, this is so frivolous, and, like, university dollars hard at work, folks.
Yeah, so we did this menstruation celebration event with, like, a lot of what we thought were, like, fun food and games that were, like, attention-grabbing, but then also, like, substantive things. Like, we had a lot of informational posters, and we collected donations of, like, boxes of pads and tampons to a local organization. And then, like, we did a follow-up t-shirt campaign and raised, like, $750 for that group. But... So in throughout that event, we tried to, like, use, like, completely, like uterus owners or, like, people with periods. Like, we tried to use, like, really inclusive language, but we did get some interesting pushback
right.
from a conservative publication. And we invited them to a meeting, and they declined, but we're hopefully going to publish a letter to the editor in our publication for regarding this.
But the general culture, yes. In terms of strides of that we've tried to make, for example, you might know about, there's a lot of uproar about the fact that Princeton has stopped using freshman as a word. I mean, for first year in frosh. I usually say first year, but for whatever reason, in front of large crowds, I say freshman because I have been nervous. but it's first year and frosh are like what me and most of my friends usually tend to call ourselves over freshmen, because there's a lot of gendered language that the university has been trying to get rid of, which is great for everyone. And most of my fellow first year friends have no problem doing it, but a lot of upperclassmen that I've noticed coming on campus just think it's absolutely ridiculous when you like introduce yourself as a first year rather than a freshman.
What's upperclassmen?
Upper class students, yes, upper class students. And pushback from, like, it's not just conservative, like, student organizations which are pushing back. I think it's just, like, the general culture as a whole where people don't feel welcome. And just because they open bathrooms at Dillon Gym, like, doesn't mean that students who identify as genderqueer can go, like, to go to the gym every single day to shower and stuff. Like, there's so much more work needs to be done culturally otherwise.
Yeah, and something, just like going off of the, like with bathrooms, like, so more generally, like, there are a lot of questions of, like, should we even have, like, explicitly gendered sexed bathrooms, but like something, like there's a pilot program now, so like the men's and women's bathrooms, like, so the women's bathrooms have like special lock codes, but they like disabled those, so, like, it's different for each dorm, so if you're, like, a student who wants to use that bathroom, like, you need to specifically, like, ask someone to get that code, like, if you don't have a friend that knows it. But they, like, just, they disabled them as, like, a pilot program. But interesting note, those exist because when women first came to Princeton, male students would run into the bathrooms and, like, yell and, like, harass them and, like, run in naked and, like, kind of do all sorts of antics to, like, essentially to, like, intimidate women, like, while they were just, like, trying to take a shower or, like, go to the bathroom. So, like, Princeton has, like, a troubled history with, like, bathrooms as well. So, like, moving forward, like, thinking about, like, whether that's still relevant, but then, like, I think the new frontier in terms of, like, issues of bathrooms on Princeton's campus is definitely, like, being inclusive of, like, trans and, like, non-gender conforming students.
I mean, that was discussed in Paul Manisky. Someone asked him, he specifically said that there is no current data that says that women are more endangered or threatened by removing a lock from the bathroom. It's a, at least in this time, it's a perception.
That is part of why you were really enthused that there was more bathroom locks. It was just like that was how it was started. So it's interesting. Another thing I wanted to point out was the USG pilot program to provide menstrual products in every bathroom in Frist. We went around putting them in on like the first trial run day, and then every single day for someone in the what is traditionally the men's bathroom would like knock them down on the ground and like throw them away, or just like be like, this doesn't belong here, and we put up signs that said like, this is why it's important, this is why it's necessary, and they were still, it's still not like running as it should be, but the ones in the traditionally women's bathrooms are being used. That was just a side note that we noticed. We were just like, come on, you guys.
Yeah. And just like quick note, like the comment section on the article reporting on this program of like having products in bathrooms were like shocking. Oh my god, let me just pull these up quickly. Sorry, we're like running out of time, but like, like, I mean, I don't know if this was a student or like someone who was reading the Daily Princetonian for whatever reason, like not as a student.
Are there any other topics or questions? We're also going to go through the kids' hospital.
Yeah. I like to jump on at the end of the discussion at the very beginning. I think you talked about fields that were more female-dominated, or women-dominated, being, why is it undervalued? You said there was a paper that a professor here doing research about this. Is there any insight to why those like fields are not as well received?
Katherine, could I speak more
with
me about this? In terms of traditionally, or anyone else here, traditionally,
more female-dominated departments not being as well-paid or valued in our society, the more the easier argument to have, or easier answer to have would be why aren't women persuaded, or why do they feel like they can't enter those male-dominated environments, but still, that's an important issue that we don't always have the answer to. Okay. But this is the comment. So one of them is the difference between equality and preferential treatment, which is a classic trope. But then also, they can afford to go to Princeton, but they can't afford that to tampons. What a bunch of pussies, no real man would want to go to a research place like that. So this is just some backlash. And then relating to, there was another one that was it will soon be an overtly LGBTQI designated school soon. There is zero tolerance at Princeton University. So whereas we think there's not enough tolerance for, the LGBT community at Princeton, some people think that being tolerant of the LGBT community means being intolerant of men.
But does anyone have any thoughts about this question about traditionally dominated?
I'm a little specific professor.
Anne Marie Slaughter?
Yeah.
So she was the dean of the Woodrow Wilson School, and she's not here now, but she wrote this book, Unfinished Business, Women, Men, and Work, where she talks a lot about, that ethics of care and
kind of
work.
We also, Sarah Jane Leslie, who's here in philosophy, has done really great work on actually an issue you talked about fields in which fields that really value genius, there's an inverse relationship to their inclusion of
philosophy.
Yeah, her name's Sarah Jane Leslie too.
There's
a teach-in in this room, I believe.
Oh, yeah, that's what I was going to say.
Two on that very subject. Unfortunately, not drawing on our campus faculty expertise in this, but people who thought about that same issue. So,
yeah. Sorry, I'm really sorry to interrupt. This sounds like a really interesting conversation, but there's actually something else in here in a few minutes. And you all have to get to where you want to go next, too.
Yeah.
Thank you both.